In my experience teaching, I find that sometimes it's difficult to make logical connections between cell division, particularly the type of cell division known as meiosis, and gamete formation, sexual reproduction, and inheritance of particular traits. We often talk about inheriting traits from our parents, but I think it's important to break this down or deconstruct this process so that we can make sense of genes, inheritance, sex, and evolution. Mitosis and meiosis are both cell division processes with fundamental similarities and differences. Mitosis occurs in all the cells of your body and is functionally responsible for bodily growth and repair. Prior to division in either mitosis or meiosis, your DNA copies itself or replicates. Your chromosomes now exist as chromatid pairs, and these pairs will separate as part of mitotic division. An extensive network of cell scaffolding, which we call the cytoskeleton, operates to anchor and divide the chromatids. In meiotic division, replicated or copied homologous pairs exist in what we call a tetrad, which refers to the four chromatids. During the formation of these tetrads, a form of genetic shuffling, known as crossing over, occurs. In meiosis, the cytoskeleton coordinates two cellular divisions, one in which homologous pairs are separated, and one in which chromatid pairs are separated. The second division, where the chromatid pairs separate, looks a lot like mitosis. The end result of meiosis is four haploid cells, as opposed to the two diploid cells that result from mitosis.
Let's spend the night together. Now I need you more than ever. Let's spend the night together now.
Whereas mitosis occurs in all the cells of your body, meiosis occurs in specialized cells in your gonads. In many of the organisms we will discuss, the gonads are the ovaries and testes. Now remember, when we're talking about meiosis, we're talking about the creation of haploid gametes, or specifically sperm and egg. We're illustrating the creation of sperm here. We'll focus on a few sperm just to illustrate the fact that these gametes are the bearers of genetic information, and they represent a great diversity of potential combinations. A successful sperm could bear an X chromosome, a Y chromosome, the allele for your father's brown hair, or something else altogether. Sperm unite with an egg post-copulation, or after sex. Now let's zoom in on these gametes. Remember, they are haploid. Each gamete represents half of the material, the genetic material, from the parent. Let's think about the connection between these cells and inheritance. We'll focus on a single individual that, in the diploid state, or with all of its chromosomes, has four chromosomes, or two homologous pairs. Remember that when we talk about homologous pairs, we're talking about complementary chromosome pairs. They have the same genes at the same locations along their length, but the genetic material may not be identical. We'll look at the locus, or the place, where a single gene is. At the location of this gene, both alleles from both parents code for the same thing. They are homozygous. In this example, the genes code for different traits. They are heterozygous. Let's look at male and female individuals and focus on a single homologous pair. When we use a Punnett square to estimate inheritance probabilities, what we're really doing is using what we know about the parents' genotypes, what they have in their genes, to estimate what could happen when they combine gametes, or, you know, what their offspring will look like. In this case, we are looking at a female that is heterozygous at the H locus as well as the R locus. The male is also heterozygous at the R locus, but homozygous for the recessive H allele. We can use a Punnett square to calculate what phenotypes are possible in their offspring. As a result of meiosis, we expect half of the female's eggs to possess the dominant allele and half to possess the recessive allele. We expect the same from the male's sperm. We combine the alleles in the way illustrated here. Imagine that the capital R codes for normal functioning hemoglobin, the molecule in your red blood cells that transports oxygen. Imagine the small R allele represents the mutant condition that leads to cell collapse, or sickling. The presence of a large R allele in either homozygous or heterozygous condition gives an individual normally functioning hemoglobin. But if you are homozygous recessive for the little r allele, we infer that you have inherited the disease known as sickle cell anemia. This type of 3-to-1 phenotypic ratio is typical when the parents are both heterozygous for a given locus. We expect a different outcome when one parent is homozygous. Recall the H allele and the fact that the male was homozygous recessive at that location on the chromosome. As revealed by the Punnett square, a cross between these two individuals leads to, in this case, two offspring with brown hair and two offspring with red hair. Or a 1-to-1 phenotypic ratio. So, let's review. At this point, you should be able to make logical connections between cell division, particularly meiotic cell division, the formation of gametes, like sperm and egg, sexual reproduction, or the combining of these gametes, and the inheritance of particular traits.